Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwortle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for our Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, excuse me. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that the Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the original name, the true original name for our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is inscrutable, incomprehensible, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. This pattern consists of, later on, he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Today we're going to have a scripture lesson of 1 John, the third chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Kenaway Kleinsmith. We'll have a prayer by Dr. Ignacio Ramirez, and that will be followed by a selection of music.
Of our hearts. Well, Yahweh, we ask in your, according to your purpose, to give us the understanding that we need, divine intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, that we can learn more about your pattern, purpose, and plan that has been operating throughout eternity unto this present day. We all ask this in your precious Holy Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In my soul.
morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the
Turn your mic on.
Yes.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by A.B. Trana of the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. First John chapter 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of Yahweh. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now we are the children of Yahweh, and it doeth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifest to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the adversary, from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of Yahweh was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the adversary. Whosoever is born of Yahweh doeth not practice sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of Yahweh. In this the children of Yahweh are manifest, and the children of the adversary. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of Yahweh, neither he hath loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his brother, and wherefore slew he him. Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the Savior's love, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso hath this world's goods, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, now how dwelleth the love of Yahweh in him? My little children, let us not love in the word, neither in the tongue, but in the deed and in the truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemn us, Yahweh is greater than our heart, and knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then we have confidence toward Yahweh. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Yahshua the Messiah, and love one another as he gave us commandment. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him, and hereby know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. I have read 1 John 3rd chapter.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for that. For our first speaker, we'd like to acknowledge our returning visitor, Fernando Valdez, right? Yeah, Fernando Valdez. Thank you for coming with us, and I hope that something is said from the floor that is edifying to you.
Well, actually, he's a former member. Not of this class, but...
Yes, he's a returning visitor from, and he's a former member of the LA branch.
Arizona,
I'm sorry. Get something right. All right, well, anyhow, for our first speaker today, I would like to call Dr. Christopher Williams, the president of the Ontario branch.
Something about this great gospel, and to bestow upon you some of the things that I've come to know and learn since being in class. Welcome. It's good to finally get to meet you. It's always good to have new blood, new guests in here. It's one thing to have them online, it's another to see you in the flesh, so it's always a pleasure. And thank you for that. A couple things in my heart and mind. And I'm going to do my best to lay a solid foundation for the next speaker, if that so happens. But this scripture is kind of timing is perfect, because me and my siblings were tasked with immortalizing my father's gravesite with, you know, how we're going to leave him. What are the words? We had four words we had to come up with. And I came up with... son in the faith. But my brother came up with something a little bit more to the point. Beloved son of Yahweh. And that's what we're here to do. Sons in the faith of Yahweh. Not of anyone else. Not of Henry Clifford Kennedy. Not of Allah, Buddha, whomever. But we're here to talk about Yahweh and Yahweh's purpose. And Yahweh laid out a blueprint of what his purpose, pattern, plan is, and that is himself in a manifestation of the archetype, original pattern of the universe, the Elohim. And Yahweh did such a great job in breaking that down. And he made it so simple. It's just a 1, 2, 3 pattern. And if you can count to three, you can understand this pattern and its simplicity. And he used vessels, such as men, women, to show his purpose, pattern, plan, and operation. So you had not just one witness, but a limitless amount of witnesses showing the unity of the Spirit in operation. And you can't beat that with anything. You can't refute it. You can't disprove it. And it stands on its own 2 feet. And that's the beautiful thing about this gospel, that it doesn't need anyone's help to prove its existence and its authenticity.
Right.
But yet, people still try to sell you on something that is not real. And I struggle with that. But since we are talking about this gospel, and we've been talking about it a lot lately, go ahead and get me the scripture lesson. Also get me Matthew 5:17. And then... we'll go from there.
3:1?
Please.
1 John 3:1. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us.
What manner of love is this? What manner of love did you deserve to get this? Like, there's nothing that we've done to deserve the manner of love that Yahweh has bestowed upon us.
Right.
Absolutely nothing. And the great thing about this love is that it was freely given, and there's no work that you have to do.
Yes, sir.
You know, I'm a business owner, and so, you know, I have, because of laws, I have this this, I'm obligated to pay for services that people give me. And likewise, they have to honor their service to me. And you would think that there is an understanding of the symbiotic relationship between employer and employee, but there isn't. People, man, has this concept of entitlement. But yet Yahweh freely gives, and his only expectation is, believe the report. And yet, truth can be presented to you, and you struggle with that idea. But let's talk about some money. Oh yeah, you owe me this. That is our mentality. Our fleshly concepts of thinking is that we are expected, we are owed these things. And no one really earns the amount of money they make when you think about it in principle. Because what that almighty dollar represents, you have to do a whole lot for it, and not everyone does. Not everyone does their fair share. But I don't want to make this about that. It's the whole fact that men in general, people in general, are entitled to these things. And they think that Yahweh is supposed to do this for you. Mm-hmm. He did this for himself.
Right.
This is his purpose, mm-hmm. his will. Everything was preordained in the day of eternity, mm-hmm. and he just spoke it, and thus it was, mm-hmm. for our benefit. This is his purpose, and he's doing it for our benefit through grace. Read.
Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of Yahweh.
Read.
Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not.
The world knoweth us not. Who is the world? Anyone that is not a son of Yahweh. Does that sound about right? And to be a son of Yahweh, you have to understand and believe that this one Yahshua Messiah did exactly what he set out to do. And what he set out to do was what? Matthew 5:17. Come on, people.
Matthew 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
He did not come to destroy this. Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
He came to perform it. Why? So that you didn't have to. Because this, my friends, is a burden. It seems real simple to do, but it was a burden. Listen, I can't even commit to going to the gym on a daily basis, let alone do all this. So he said, hey, you know what? I recognize I'm going to impose this law on them so that I can show them that they need me. That was it. So that you can need me. I created you, but I created you with a carnal mind so that you can think that you are it, but really, I'm it.
Right.
And so that you can understand that and recognize that I'm going to impose this on you. That is what he did. Read.
For verily I say unto you, mm-hmm. till heaven and earth pass, mm-hmm. one yod mm-hmm. or the smallest part of a letter.
So that means he's not going to leave any doubt. He's going to cross every T, dot every I, to show that he is the one to take this out of the way. Read.
Shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
All be fulfilled. Now get back to John.
Two, beloved, now are we the children of Yahweh, mm-hmm. and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Mm-hmm. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him,
read.
Where we shall see him as he is.
Now what we should be doing. That's what he said, right? When we see him, we should be doing these things, correct? But what do we do? The exact opposite. Kind of like this one Satan, right? Because that was according to a purpose. We do these things according to a purpose so that he can show his power over Satan. And this ain't a bad thing.
Right.
And I don't want anyone to mistake that this figure here, he is an asset, not a liability.
Right.
And the fact that he shows you where you are in the scheme of things. When you fall short of being righteous, it lets you know exactly what lessons you need to learn to get to that point of being in righteousness. And righteousness at one time was this law. Mm-hmm. But he said, I'm going to take this out of the way. So the question is, what is righteousness now? Righteousness now is representing these attributes in the flesh. Intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, and justice. Foundation, power, and strength. Having that manifest so that people can see that represented in you. That's righteousness today. Not this stuff that we're talking about right here. Sin and us. It says, jump down where it says about the sin. There's
whoever committed sin transgresses also the law.
Okay.
For sin is a transgression of the law.
Now, what law are we talking about? Are we talking about the law of California? We talking about the federal government's law? We talking about what law? The law of Moses, right? That's the law that he was talking about. Unless you transgress this law, which was not given to us.
Right.
Because last time I checked, I'm a heathen. According to what we're talking about, we're all Gentiles, right?
Right.
Unless we were born back then, the law, this law doesn't apply to us. Mm-hmm. But yet, we got billions of people trying to keep this law.
Right.
In part because they don't want to do all that stuff, right? Mm-hmm. Ain't nobody sacrificing any animals for their sins. And believe me, they break them all. I mean, there are 613 judgment statutes or ordinances that no one talks about, but they don't talk about the 10.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's easy to talk about the 10. Like I said, if I could eat right, go to gym every day, and not swear, believe me, I wasn't doing this. I break all them laws every day of the week, okay? So that's just me. Don't even talk about my kids. I mean, I'm just saying. At the end of the day, the point of this law was to subjugate them for a reason. They needed to feel that pressure. It was a burden like a big dog, okay? And the whole point was so that he can perform it and take it out of the way. Jeremiah 31:31.
Jeremiah 31:31.
Mm-hmm.
The day hath come, saith Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, the day hath come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the mm-hmm. house of Israel.
So in order to make a new covenant, he had to establish an old covenant.
Okay. Read. With the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
Read.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt.
So when he made that covenant with Abraham, he took them out of the Canaan's land, brought them down to Egypt, subjected them to all kind of turmoil for 400 years, and took them out of this, and then brought them to a new land. And even once they got up here, they still messed it up. Entitlement. Entitlement. They were never happy. Just never happy. Kind of like we are today. We ain't never satisfied. Absolutely not. Never satisfied. Read.
Which my covenant they break.
All the time. Read.
Although I was an husband unto them, saith Yahweh.
Not just a husband, a good husband.
Right.
Shoes never wore out. Never went hungry. Always had light. I mean, they were fed. They were clothed. Show a little adventure, a little war, make them get an assignment and whatnot, a little entertainment. It was entertaining watching people bring their goats and turtle doves to the damn altar. What are you talking about? Can you imagine? I mean, it's like reality TV back here. They get to see, Girl, did you see what Will did? What do you do? He got a turtle dove, an ox, and a lamb. I mean, that's how. That's what we're talking about here. Read.
But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel.
This is going to be the covenant. Read.
After those days, saith Yahweh, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts.
After those days. What are those days? The death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. After those days, then you'll get this. Read.
And will be their Elohim.
Uh-huh.
And they shall be my people.
Read.
And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know ye Yahweh, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh.
Yahweh is preached globally, is it not? The name Yahweh is global. There's not one religion, there's not one sect of religion that doesn't know the name Yahweh. That came to pass. No one has to teach the next man about how to treat each other. That is innate. That has been bred. That is part of our nature now. He did what he said he was going to do. The problem is, man, in their infinite stupidity, incredible arrogance, still thinks that they are above it all. We live in a society where they think the almighty dollar is everything. That's how we live in this society. Today's society is no different than it was back then. Name a war. Name one war from back here to now that wasn't about money. Just name one. There's not one war that wasn't about the dollar. Everything is done in the name of money. But they'll disguise it as something else.
Right.
The Crusades, they'll say it was about religion. Mm-hmm. At that time, people thought that if they had that city, they would be the capital of the world, and they can control all the commerce, and control everything. Because everything has been about money. The Civil War. People think Abraham Lincoln did that to save the slaves. That was just the smokescreen. It was about money. Slaves equal currency. Free labor is money. And at the time, between the North and the South was kicking the North's tail. They couldn't keep up with that kind of commerce. Free labor. The Industrial Revolution had just hit. And they wanted to make the Industrial Revolution a national thing. And they couldn't outpace free labor. So they tried to abolish slavery. Thus, money became the driver. But the smokescreen was about the slaves. Make no mistake about it. Abraham Lincoln had slaves. But at the end of the day, money conquers all. They were just more sophisticated in the North. It's the only difference. I didn't learn that until I got in college. Since I had the same high school story, read the same story, I read all about it in high school, could give a damn. I could care less. What my mind was. But when you go back and read it, read your history and study up on it, there's not one war that hasn't been about money. Oil equates to money. The Middle East is rich in that, is it not? Africa is rich in minerals, oil, the whole nine yards. That is why Africa is, everything great comes from Africa. Every great resource comes in Africa. And that's why the British colonized it in the manner in which they did. Because they ain't stupid. The French colonized Africa for the same reason. That's all they do. Colonization is about resources, expanding your reach, globalization, the almighty dollar. That's crazy to me. But that's how we think. That's how man thinks. But that is not righteousness. That is not what Yahweh is about. Listen, there is nothing more greater than this gospel of Yahshua Messiah. Because that is your eternal life, which is wrapped up in. Because if you are willing to sacrifice your eternity for money, you can have it.
Really?
I don't care if I have another dime, it's going to have a anything to go against my salvation. Mm-hmm. There ain't enough money to place on my salvation. It just ain't. You don't believe me, Jeff? Ask Jeffrey Epstein.
Really?
What enough money is like to please that man? And he was in hell on earth. He's probably free now compared to where he was, I'll be honest with you. Because that is a hard life to live. You know, can you imagine having that on your heart and mind every day? Knowing what you're doing because you are sick inside? Because he didn't have the love of Yahweh. He wasn't, his eyes weren't on the throne somewhere else.
Yeah.
Same thing with everybody else that is doing all these corrupt, terrible things. There is no way to live. You can't live like that. You know, if you are not giving of yourself and servicing others for the sake of their benefit and not your own, you are wasting away. There is no life to live like that. That is not how Yahweh treated his creation. I mean, freely gave it to us.
Right.
And yet, we can't reciprocate the same lesson. It just doesn't make any sense. Are we done in Jeremiah? Jeremiah.
For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
For I will forgive their iniquity,
mm-hmm.
and I will remember their sin no more.
Now, I don't know anyone in this room or out of this room that don't have skeletons in their closet. Now, don't get me wrong. Not everyone's skeletons are the same. I would hope you don't have skeletons as bad as mine. You haven't lived long enough. But if you do, please give it to yourself. But everyone has skeletons. And there is always redemption from your past.
Yep.
Hell, there's redemption from your present if you so want it to be so. All you have to do is repent. Change your behavior. Change your focus. Get right. And you'll be fine. But if you do not have faith that Yahshua Messiah did exactly what he said he did, if you don't believe what is written, what has been proven, then you're wasting your time here. Are we done?
Thus saith Yahweh, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon, and of the stars for a light by night.
Yeah, we're done. Get back to John, please.
John 3.
I think we're at 6.
6. Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the adversary.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the adversary.
Read.
Likewise, must the deacons be grave, not double tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre.
Mm-hmm.
Holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. And let these also first be proved, then let them use the office of a deacon.
It's 18. 18, please.
18. There is no
18.
No, you're
reading.
What are you reading? I'm
reading the wrong chapter.
That explains a few things.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Where are we at?
John 1 and
3. 3 and 6. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not.
Right.
Whosoever sinneth
mm-hmm.
hath not seen him,
mm-hmm.
neither known him.
Mm-hmm.
Little children, let no man deceive you.
Now, he said this because people are going to come to deceive you.
Right.
And we got to remember the lesson between a deception and a lie. People lie, but deception a little further. I mean, that takes a lot of thought, a lot of woven lies put together. I mean, no death will you die. He wasn't lying,
right.
Sort of. You know what I mean? She didn't die physically, but she did spiritually,
right?
And that's worse. Read.
He that doth righteousness
mm-hmm.
is righteous, even he that is righteous.
Mm-hmm.
He that committed sin
mm-hmm.
is of the adversary.
Right.
For the adversary sinneth from the beginning.
Now, we're talking about being under this law. Now we have to rightly divide the word of truth, meaning what was valid in one age may not be valid in another. Now if Yahshua the Messiah died, resurrected, tearing in the earth, and then ascended, and then outpouring the Holy Spirit, fulfilled the law and the prophets, and took that out of the way, the question is, what is sin today, if there is no law? Now, some people still believe in this law. We'll fight you tooth and nail about this law.
Right.
But if this law is still valid, did Yahshua Messiah do what he said he did? Or did he not? Because if Matthew says, think not that I come to destroy the law and the prophets, I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Right.
And if the prophecy says, I'm going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, that is going to be written in your heart and mind, did he do it or did he not?
Yes, he did.
That is the question. Because the gospel of Yahshua Messiah is the death, burial, resurrection, ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That is the gospel. So if he did not do that, in fact, then the question is, what's the new covenant versus what's the old covenant? It's a rhetorical question. But that's what we're here to discover. That's what we're talking about. Read.
For this purpose, the Son of Yahweh was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the adversary.
Read.
Whosoever is born of Yahweh doth not practice sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of Yahweh.
Now, if you're born of Yahweh, meaning you have realized who he is and what he did, you are born of Yahweh. You are a believer in the Son and Messiah. Meaning, you believe the report. You no longer are subjected to this law. You understand there is no sin in this age. You understand that now you are filled with the Holy Spirit and that you walk in a newness of life. Not this fear that something's going to happen. You can't have fear in this world. I mean, bad things are going to happen every day. You can't help that. But you can't live waiting for that to happen. That's not living. You literally waiting for something bad to happen. That's stressful. I don't know who does that. Well, who can do that? That is too much for me. Read.
In this, the children of Yahweh are manifest, and the children of the adversary. Whosoever doth not righteousness is not of Yahweh, neither he that loveth not his brother.
Read.
For this is the message that ye hear heard from the beginning, that we should love one another.
Read.
Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one,
right,
and slew his brother.
Right.
And wherefore slew he him?
Read.
Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous.
Read.
Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto life.
Now the world is going to hate you when you become a son of Yahweh. I hate to say this, but even in Nehemiah, they're going to hate you for being a son of Yahweh. We are the epitome of that hatred because we are sons of Yahweh in Ontario. Do you understand? This was meant to happen, folks.
Yes.
The maltreatment, the backbiting, the backstabbing, all that. It was meant to happen. This is no surprise to sons of Yahweh. So don't marvel at it. Just keep on walking. Walk in the faith. Free of fear. Read.
I'm going to do 13 again. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren.
Read.
He that loveth not his brother abideth in death.
Listen, you're going to have enemies till the day you die. Love them anyway. I have people in my life that can't understand why I still treat people that mistreat me well. They don't understand it. It is for that reason. I'm a son of Yahweh. They don't understand who they are and why they do what they do.
Right.
But it doesn't mean I have to be subjected to the same treatment. I don't have to treat them the same way. That means that I am living a righteous life. Not because I'm better than them, because I see the big picture. I understand what's going on. I don't do what I do for conditional love. I'm an unconditional person. I don't care if you're rich or poor, I'm gonna treat you the same. When I'm in my station, the big boss, I say hello to, no different than the person pushing the broom and cleaning up the place. They're the same people to me.
Right.
That is how this gospel teaches you, raises you up. There are no big eyes and little U's in this world when you understand the purpose of Yahweh. But if you walk around thinking that you're better than somebody else because you have more or you've done more, you are the problem.
Thank you. Yes, that's right.
So I'll be frank with you. When I see celebrities and everybody, oh my gosh, it's Kim Kardashian. Are you kidding me? I could care less. Kim Kardashian is no better than Samuel Salas.
I heard.
And when I see Samuel, hey Samuel, how you doing? That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
But if we treat people because of their status, then you are the one with the issue. And you're not a son of Yahweh. You're somebody else. Because that's not why we're here to learn how to be. And listen, you don't need to listen to me to tell you that. I'm not trying to scold anyone. I'm just telling you about who I am. I have to be the example. Not for you, but for myself.
Right.
I have responsibilities to myself. Because my salvation is my own. What you do for your salvation is on you. But believe you me, if you're coming to this class and you're hearing this gospel, you will be saved. Because it speaks for itself and stands alone.
That's right.
Read.
Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer.
Read.
And ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him.
And when we say you're a murderer, we're not talking about literally. We're talking about spiritually. You ever seen someone just hate another person and just kills their soul? Mm-hmm. I mean, just beats them down.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I was having a conversation with my boys this morning. Why do you guys mistreat each other? But you get mad when somebody else mistreats you guys.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense. Y'all brothers. Mm-hmm. Well, didn't your brother treat you? Wait, you're right. And look at them now. They are in just turmoil. But I never treat them the way they treat me. This gospel teaches me the exact opposite of that. Man, I really can't make this stuff up. Read.
Hereby perceive we the Savior's love, because he laid down his life for us,
mm-hmm.
and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren.
Read.
But whoso hath this world's goods,
mm-hmm.
and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowel of compassion
Read.
From him, how dwelleth the love of Yahweh in him?
Right.
My little children, mm-hmm. let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth.
Read that again.
My little children, let us not love in word, nor in tongue.
Wait. Let us not love in word and tongue. What does that mean?
Lip service.
Exactly. Talk is cheap.
Right.
I know people that you can tell them, I love you, but slap the hell out of them and they think you love them.
Mm-hmm.
Because they think that your passion's coming out and that's just you showing you care so much that you just go in rage.
Mm-hmm.
That's not love, folks.
Nope.
Anybody can say, I love you. Read.
My little children, let us not love in word,
mm-hmm.
nor in tongue,
Read.
But in deed and in truth.
Now, when you actually do display love through action, through actual things that are done to show how you really feel, that's love.
Right.
Now, love is not this romantic fantasy that you see on TV. That's not love.
Mm-hmm.
Love is saying, hey, I know you're a nice guy and all, but you really need to do something about your breath. Now, to somebody, I might be like, hey, he's just being mean.
Mm-hmm.
But if 20 other people are talking bad about your breath and you don't know it, no one gives a damn about you. It takes a lot of gumption to walk with someone, hey man, you can put the breath mint in your mouth because you're killing these folks over here. I'm not joking. And it seems harsh, and I'm using that as an example. It's even better. You know, you're not doing a good job in school. You're failing, you're doing this, that, and the other. You need to change your behavior. To tell someone about themselves, the truth, that's love.
Right.
Because if right. I'm not going to tell you, who's going to tell you?
That's right.
You really waiting for your teacher, your instructor, a piece of paper to tell you, hey, you're failing? So I'm not going to be proactive. Let's bring it home. Hey, your salvation is wrapped up in believing this report. If you don't believe in Yahshua Messiah, you are going to hell. Not physically so, but spiritually so.
Right.
If I don't take the time to at least teach you about Yahshua Messiah in the gospel, then I do not love you.
Right.
That's real. Mm-hmm. How do you think we come to class every Sunday? On Thursday, on Thursday, on Tuesdays, or Friday, or whichever day we go. We come here so that we can learn about this gospel so that someone can tell us the truth. Because people don't want to hear the truth. No one wants to hear that, hey, you're a bit of a jerk. Am I fat? Yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Do something about it. There's nothing wrong with saying what's real. But I want people to get this misconception about who they are. Just because I can be good to you, but I mistreat you, does not make me a good person.
Right.
It makes me a conditional person.
Right.
Maybe you can give me something that you can't, mm-hmm. or vice versa. But if I can treat you the same as I treat you, now there's something to that. That's me showing you and displaying love. That's my deed. I can tell you all nice things. Hey, Erica, you're the greatest. And then behind your back, that chick is crazy. That's not love. We don't want to display that form of love. That's just lip service, like you said. We want to walk in righteousness. We want people to see us coming a mile away. And listen, there's no happy. You can't fake around here. The greatest litmus test is Kennaway Clenchman. I am not gonna lie to you. You cannot come in here in front. You are 100% effective in calling a spade when someone's bringing up some crazy stuff on this floor. Am I right? You can't make this stuff up. And there's not one person in this class gonna let you just get away with that. Because we want you to teach the truth.
Right.
We don't wanna hear no lies up here. That's not what we're here for. We're here to talk about what thus saith Yahweh according to the scriptures and leave your opinions at the door. That's all we care about. Read.
And hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him.
Mm-hmm.
For if our hearts condemn us, Yahweh is greater than our heart and knoweth all things.
Mm-hmm.
Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence towards Yahweh. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight.
I'm going to be frank with you. This past, I say, 3 months, it's been the worst 3 months of my life ever. I mean, by far the worst. And if it wasn't for this gospel and the lessons that my father taught me over the years, mm-hmm. I don't think I'd be here. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be standing here. I wouldn't be okay. I'd be in bad shape. Mm-hmm. And it is... Verse 18 is why I even want to talk today. I've been dealing with verse 18 for the last 3 years, and it kills me that people can tell you something,
mm-hmm.
but not show you something.
Right.
Thank you. Bless you.
No, that's right.
love my kids because I'm obligated to. I really don't. I made a choice to do that. I've chosen to be a father to my children. And it ain't easy. And anyone that chooses to be a parent to another person is making one heck of a choice to stand up and say, hey, I'm gonna be responsible for you. And anytime you make that decision, whether it be for a parental situation or, hey, I'm choosing to be in a relationship with you or I'm gonna spend my quality time, that is a choice. And you're making that decision to do. Likewise, when you come to this class, you made a choice to choose Yahweh versus something else. Like, it's like the Pepsi Challenge. You wanna take it or not? Because you can go out there and go to church because they have nice bands and choirs and all that good stuff. But we choose to come here for a reason. Because there's truth here. You can get fed here. You can learn something here. And listen, we have different people that have different talents here. And that's what I love most about this class. We are a hodgepodge of an amalgamation of people come together and make one heck of a class. And we are surrounded by the gospel. I mean, literally by a panoramic vision. And you can't get this anywhere else. Not in the manner in which we give it. So, you know, to me, this gospel has saved my life. It has given me hope. It has given me resolve. And I didn't earn it. It was just given to me. And hopefully, you see it the same way as I do. Because we could, even when I'm not here, I'm in class. I don't think I've ever stopped coming to class. So, I mean, I'd be here physically, but I'm always here in spirit. And when you understand this gospel the way it should be understood, you are in heaven on earth. And as bad as I feel physically, spiritually, I still have resolve. I'm still at peace, knowing that my future is bright. Regardless of my physical situation, my future is bright. My destination, my destination is where I need to be.
That's right.
But love is not something that we talk about. It's not this feeling. It is about what we do. And I love the brethren. I love everyone for being here. And I thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to talk about the gospel, give a brief testimony on how I feel and what I see just in the scripture lesson. That's, as soon as I saw it, I'm like, gosh, I got to get it. At least if I get a chance, I'm going to talk about that. Got in a little different direction. But when that came up, I had to do it. But thank you very much for the opportunity. Hope you got some of what was said today. Hallelujah.
Thank you for that. Appreciate the remarks from the previous vessel. For our next speaker, we will have the interim dean, Dr. Will Williams. I appreciate the previous speaker and what he had to say. And I too am glad to be in this class because the things that are taught in this class are the things that will keep you stable. And I always like to preface by saying this is great, colossal, stupendous, panoramic vision given to us by Yahweh our Lord. And it is the thing that at the end of this age, that if you have the knowledge and understanding of it, we'll save you. Okay? I'd like to draw on some elements that the previous speaker brought up. And he brought up a lot of things, he really did. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to make this gumbo soup here, you know, tasty enough, but I'm going to give it a try. Let's get Romans 8 and 1. start there first. I think it's what I want.
Romans 8 and 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
Now that's what the previous speaker was talking about. That once you are in Yahshua Messiah, the condemnation that this and other similar things brought about is there no more. It's gone. That's why Paul says there's, and he's speaking of himself personally. He said, now there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Yahshua the Messiah.
Who walk not after the flesh, after the spirit.
Who walk not after the flesh. Now what he's talking about these physical things. Not just necessarily these 613 ordinances, any cardinal ordinance that any man has given you. See, and we're gonna try to tie this together, I hope, you know. I'm trying to lay a little groundwork here, but keep going there.
For the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua, the Messiah, has made me free from the law of sin and death.
Now see, this is the law. Listen carefully. Read that line again.
For the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua, the Messiah.
Now the law of the spirit of life, which is in Yahshua, the Messiah, which is the same law that runs everything in this universe.
Right.
The law of the spirit. Okay. Now this is letting you know, this is the law of the spirit of life.
Right.
See, which is in Yahshua Messiah, which should be in you, right, or recognized in you, put it like that. Keep going.
Has made me free from the law of sin and death.
Now, this is the law of sin and death, or what I like to call LSD. Because if you think you're going to get salvation, you know, by doing any of these cardinal ordinances or the ones that you make up, you're truly hallucinatory and delusional. See? The law of sin and death. Yeah, this is the LSD here, you know, that people think you can take it, you know. Oh, I'm on a good trip here, you know. I'm getting water baptized. I'm eating the Lord's Supper.
Right.
Oh, I'm getting circumcised. I don't know how to get your Genesis. I can tell you a good story about that in Genesis. About Jacob's sons on that one, but I won't deviate, but continue.
For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh.
It was weak. This was weak through the flesh. In other words, and here you are trying to do it.
Right.
And then you know it's weak through the flesh. And here you are still trying to.
I didn't do it, yeah.
Give me something that's strong.
Right.
See, the spirit law, see, that's the thing, see. Because that's where it all emanates from. Continue.
Yahweh sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh.
Now here he is in the likeness of sinful flesh. Now if he just was standing right up here, you would think him no more different than anybody else. He could look like a bum out on the street. You wouldn't know it. You couldn't tell. He's in the likeness of sinful flesh. Read.
Because of sin, to condemn sin in the flesh.
To condemn sin in the flesh. In other words, a righteous man had to be offered up for an unrighteous man. And see, and we were the unrighteous men because all men died through Adam.
Right.
So you can't get a sinner to to save another sinner. To redeem, that's the word. To redeem another sinner. You gotta have a righteous man for that.
Right.
See, you gotta have a pure sacrifice for that. See. And that's what he represented. All right, continue.
That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us.
That the righteousness of these things might be fulfilled in us. Tell you a little secret. We really do believe in baptism. We really do believe in circumcision. We believe in ceremonies, Passover, circumcision, Ten Commandments. We believe in these things. It's just not physical.
Right.
See, it's a spiritual baptism. It's a spiritual circumcision. See? It's a spiritual law we're operating now. It's in the spirit. See, that's the difference. Continue.
Who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit.
After the spirit. Continue.
For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh.
Now, see, now if you're after the flesh, this is what you're going to mind after. Oh, I got to eat the Lord's Supper this week. I got to get down to the church. I got to get baptized. I got to get my children baptized. Or else they won't be saved. I got to do this. I got to do that ceremony. And look, it's not just these. The whole world does this. Okay? I could go on with this, but I'm going to read the next scripture just to see where I'm at.
But they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
For to be carnally minded is death.
Now see, to be carnally minded or to be engulfed in these things, that's death.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's just telling you quite plainly. In other words, if you go out and get water baptized, you may as well just go ahead and kill yourself.
Right.
Spiritually speaking, that's what it is. It's spiritual speech that is death. Because it's not going to, look, water without a bar of soap is not going to do you any good on the outside. I know. I used to work in a hospital, and I had patients, really old patients. I had to tell them for the ADLs, activities of daily living. You know, before breakfast, go clean yourself up. And they would try to cheat and just get wet and without no soap. And I'm like, wait a minute. You was funky dry. Now you're going to come out funky wet. Boy, go back there and use some soap, you know? Get some of that dirt off, you know?
Right.
See, now, that's just for the outside. What about for the inside?
Right.
You
know?
See?
True.
What's going to clean that up? Okay? Mm-hmm. Continue.
For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
I see that to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Okay, I'll conclude for that right there, because Paul goes on with that. But what I wanted to get to is draw some of the elements. The first speaker talked about this law and entitlement stuff. I want to kind of show a little bit of the origins of it, what it has gotten to as of today, but to find out, where did it come from? Mm-hmm. How did it come about?
Right.
See, now, we tell you this is a vision. This is a great vision revelation given to our founder, Henry Clifford Kidman. And he drew illustrations to draw out what he saw in the vision. And he just made one little statement. Make me prove this mm-hmm. to your satisfaction. Don't believe me because I said so. Because that's what you've been doing before you came up in here.
Right.
But make me prove this to your satisfaction. Go out and look at the evidence here, okay? Now, first speaker talked about a pattern. And see this pattern here? This is a pattern, let's read it. Hebrews 8:5. Now I've really got a fly now.
Hebrews 8:5. I'll start with 4. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, mm-hmm. as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mountain.
All right. This is the mount. Here's Moses here. This was shown to him in the mount, this pattern. It's a pattern of heavenly things. This migratory pattern is a pattern of, how can I put it, the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is called the universe. As you can see here, we have outer court, it should be court roundabout, that's let you know how old this chart is. Egypt would be like the court roundabout
right.
of this pattern. The wilderness of Sinai would be like the holy place of this pattern. Canaan's land would be like the most holy place of this pattern. See, three different parts, but one. This is the greater and more perfect sanctuary. How so? Because the universe is a physical creation, an angelic creation, and a spirit law. Perhaps a better illustration would be this one here. This chronology chart we call ages and dispensations. Here we have an angelic creation with a dotted line for the physical creation, because it lets you know that there's an interaction going on there, okay? Both of these are embedded in within Yahweh. The creation abides within Yahweh, or eternity, and the cloud here symbolizes eternity.
Right.
All right? So we have the physical creation, the angelic creation, and then we have spirit law. Now, Romans 1:19-20. I'm trying to get some precepts here together, some predicates. That's what I'm trying to do here. Because I have a subject. Go ahead.
Romans 1:19. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
Mm-hmm.
For the invisible things of him, from the creation of the world are clearly seen,
mm-hmm.
being understood by the things that are made,
mm-hmm.
even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
All right. So it takes the natural to understand the spiritual. To understand the invisible things, we can look at things that are visible, that are natural, right? Even his eternal power and supernal nature. We'll go backwards. The supernal nature, 1 John 5:7.
For there are three that bear record in heaven,
mm-hmm.
the Father,
mm-hmm.
the Word, and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And these three are one.
So these three are one. Not three, not a trinity, but one, a unity. All right, continue.
Eight. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one.
Now these three agree in one. In other words, these three point to that one. Okay, continue.
If we receive the witness of men, the witness of Yahweh is greater.
Now this is the witness of Yahweh, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And this is the greatest witness of all. That you can't come up with anything better
right.
than these three witnesses.
Right.
Yeah.
Continue.
For this is the witness of Yahweh, which he has testified of his Son.
Mm-hmm.
He that believeth on the Son of Yahweh has the witness in himself.
Now, you have this witness in yourself, actually,
right.
whether you believe it or not. Because
yeah.
everybody in here has blood running warm in their veins.
That's right.
You have water running in your veins, and you have a spirit that's animating you. Now, if you're missing one of these three, then maybe we need to call them more.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And get you up out of here, because, right. you know, we don't want diseases, cholera, and all that stuff. See, you're in the wrong spot. See, but, and see, that would disprove an atheist. Atheist, oh, there ain't no proof for God. And here you are walking around.
Right.
You know, when you walk around, you're the proof that there is a creator in existence. Your existence is proof of his existence.
Mm-hmm.
It's really that simple. Okay, go ahead.
He that believeth not Yahweh hath made him a liar.
Now, you didn't call him a liar. You made your own self a liar because you existed.
That's right.
See, and here's another thing. People say, well, about his name. His name is Yahweh. And so, well, it don't matter what you call him. Well, it matters what he calls you. I'll tell you what. Put my name on your paycheck.
Really?
All right? See how much it matters then.
Right.
Okay? And here's something else. Here you got a deity that can create the sun, moon, and stars, that create life, you know, the plants, the animals, the man, and he hasn't got enough sense to tell somebody who he is.
Mm-hmm.
But here you are, you ain't done none of this stuff, but you'll be ready, you know, but fighting somebody call you out your name.
Right.
Oh, no, oh, my name is such and such. You know, well, what have you done? Well, I ain't did nothing, but my name is such and such. You ain't did nothing, but you can tell somebody who you are. Here, this creator is,
yeah.
and create everything. He ain't got no sense to tell somebody who he is. Well, he said his name is Yahweh. I take his word at it.
Point
myself.
Yeah.
Okay? I mean, if he do anything else, I'm pretty sure he can tell somebody what his name is. Continue.
Because he believeth not the record that Yahweh gave his Son.
Now, this is the record Yahweh gave his Son, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And listen, these are synonymous. These are principles. Get 1 Corinthians 15:3.
1 Corinthians 15:3.
Uh-huh.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, of that Yahshua died for our sins.
As Yahshua died for our sins, that's a death.
According to the scriptures.
Uh-huh.
And that he was buried.
He was buried, a burial. Go ahead.
And that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures.
And he resurrected. Resurrection. According to the scriptures. Well, see, that's synonymous with blood. Water and spirit.
Right.
They're synonymous. These are the witnesses you're going to find just basically throughout all the Bible, throughout all the scriptures. See, just to give you a quick example, then I'm going to move on to my particular subject because I know I'm running late. Genesis 21:9, I think, is what I want.
Genesis 21 and 9. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, which she had borne unto Abraham, mocking.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son Isaac. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight on account of his son. And Elohim said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad, mm-hmm. and because of thy bondwoman, and all that Sarah hath said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called.
In Isaac shall thy seed be called. Why? Because he was the seed of promise.
Mm-hmm.
See, he represents the spiritual or the righteous principle. Right? Whereas Ishmael, who was born after the flesh, not that Ishmael was evil, he wasn't, but it's just showing you a principle, that's right. All. Mm-hmm. See, he's representing the physical or the flesh. Okay, go ahead.
And also, of the son of the bondwoman will I make a nation, because he is thy seed.
Because he's thy seed, I'm going to take care of him, I'm going to bless him too. And he did. Ishmael, you read on, not in this, but Ishmael eventually had 12 sons that became 12 nations itself. And they all believed in Elohim. Okay, but continue quickly.
And Abraham rose up early in the morning and took bread and a bottle of water and gave it unto Hagar, putting it on her shoulder and the child, and sent her away.
And the child, and this child, let me tell you how old this child was. This child was 15 years old. And you know, some people are big at 15, like old boy back there. But I'm just letting you know, this says child, people think it's like a little, but I'm letting you know he was 15 years old. Okay, so continue.
And she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. And the water was spent in the bottle, and she cast a child under one of the shrubs.
Uh-huh.
And she went and sat her down over against him a good way off, as it were a bow shot.
A bow shot. A bow shot is like about 100 yards, about the length of a football field. Okay? In other words, this is what she did. The child is dying, and she got tired, and she just buried the child under a shrub and then walked away about the length of a football field. We walked away from it. Mm-hmm. And she said what?
For she said, let me not see the death of the child.
So far as she was concerned, Ishmael is dead and buried. Mm-hmm. Because she hid him under a shrub.
Right.
So he's dead and buried.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
And she sat over against him and lifted up her voice and wept.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of Elohim called to Hagar out of the heavens and said unto her, what aileth thee, Hagar?
Mm-hmm.
Fear not, for Elohim hath heard the voice of the lad where he is.
Mm-hmm.
Arise, lift up the lad.
Arise, walk back over there. He didn't say that, but that's what she had to do. Walk back over there and lift the lad up.
Mm-hmm.
Why? That's a resurrection.
Right.
Because he was dead and buried in her mind.
Mm-hmm.
Go back up and resurrect this child now. That's a death, burial, resurrection, in principle. Mm-hmm. And these are the kind of things you'll see throughout the scriptures. Why? Because it's pointing to him. His death, his burial, his resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, I want to address this thing about the law thing. Now, the law, when this tabernacle was made, Moses went up to get tables of stone. When he came back down, he saw these Israelites worshiping the golden calf. So he broke the first tables of stone, then he had to hew himself out a second table.
Right.
And bring it back up. The second table had to fit into the indentation of the mountain where the first ones had came out of, Elohim would write with his finger again on those, okay? When this tabernacle was made, and the Ark of the Covenant was made, the tables of stone was put into the Ark of the Temple, the Ark of the Covenant, and it represented the law that governed the whole body of Israel.
Right.
Now, we have read in Romans about the law of the Spirit. This is what Dr. Kinley tried to get across to folks. One, this is a school. It is not a church.
Right.
We say that all the time. Fine. If you're a school, what's your curriculum?
Mm.
Here it is. Elohim, the archetype of the original pattern of the universe. What does this curriculum consist of? It consists of explaining how Elohim, who is the resurrected Yahshua Messiah, is the spirit law that governs everything in this creation.
Right.
Now, I had to do this sometimes. Because it takes the natural to understand the spiritual, right?
Right.
We have natural laws, so-called. You know, we've heard of them, law of gravity, law of motion, and all like that. This is a law. This is called Ohm's Law. It's the law of electricity. One of them, there's several of them, but this is the main one. This is the reason why the lights work, believe it or not. Because the E stands for voltage, the I stands for current, the R stands for resistance. I learned this. This is the way this guy taught me using circles. I learned this. I took an FCC class once for getting a FCC license and all, and I had to learn this stuff. But if I didn't know what the resistance was, I could find out what the voltage and the current is and multiply the two, and that will give me the resistance. If I didn't know what the current was, all I had to do was find out what the voltage is and the resistance and divide the voltage from the resistance, and that would give me the current. It's a formula, all right? Ohm's Law. Now, Friedrich Ohm's, of whom Yahweh showed this to, what's the scripture? John 3:27.
John 3:27.
Now, we call it Ohm's Law. Not that Friedrich Ohm's invented this law, but he was the one that Yahweh allowed to see.
Right. Mm-hmm.
All right? Because if we named everything Yahweh's laws, you wouldn't be able to distinguish one law from the other. So we'll say Ohm's Law, or we'll say something like Isaac Newton's Law of Gravity,
right.
A Law of Motion, rather, that kind of thing. But do we have that?
3:27.
John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear
witness. Now, a man can receive nothing except it be given to him from heaven. Now we know where all these discoveries and inventions come from. People say, I dreamed that I had an inspiration. Well, where did it come from? It came from Yahweh. That's where it came from. Okay? Now, here's the natural law here, all right, that shows you how the lights work. Now, if you break Ohm's Law or violate it or do not follow this law to its parameters, the lights aren't gonna work. That's a death. Why? Because it's a principle. It points to the law of the spirit. You try to violate or break the law of the spirit, the penalty is death.
Right.
It's really that simple. It's just like these laws here. See, these laws never saved anybody. But it shouldn't have can condemn you. Because the scripture says he who despises Moses' law died under this law under 2 or 3 witnesses. This law could condemn you. The penalty for breaking this law was death. Something had to die. A sacrifice that was brought forth, you know. Okay, because we got the illustration over here. See, we got it over here. See, you could be. See, we'll say Chris is over here. He's from the tribe of Gershon. He had messed up. Okay, so he's coming around the corner here. I'm sitting over here, Dan. And I see, me and the fellas, we just out here jumping. We're on the stoop. And here comes Chris come walking by, you know. He's got a bullock and a turtle dove and a couple of rams. It's like, wait a minute. What's going on with you? Got a bull. Wait a minute. Let's look this up. Oh, okay, yeah, you better get around that corner quick, buddy. You gotta hurry up, boy. Yeah, buddy, yeah. That sacrifice can't wait, man. I'm just saying, you know, that's the way it was. You know, your business is out on Front Street.
Right.
You know, pretty much. Okay? Now, the penalty was death. Something had to die.
Right.
In some cases, you would have to die.
Right.
There are other cases where if your child did something, the whole family would have to die. Something was going to pay the penalty.
That's right.
Pay the price of the penalty for violating that law. And the price was death. Something had to die. See. Therefore, Yahweh said, you know, even I think he says in Psalms, he says, I am getting sick and tired of these bloods of bullocks and goats and stuff. I'm just getting tired of this, you know. Therefore, I'm going to do this myself. I come myself. Nobody else was worthy.
Right.
Moses wasn't worthy. Mm-hmm. Abraham wasn't worthy. Even Enoch, he was translated. He wasn't worthy. None of them was worthy. Save he who came in the likeness of sinful flesh. See, to be the propitiation of our sins. To be the righteous man. To make an atonement for the unrighteousness of man. Okay? Now, I want to get into these laws and stuff, this entitlement business. Now, there was a law up here in this garden. Do not touch this tree or eat of it. Mm-hmm. All right? And Yahweh knew that they were going to do it, because if you look at the word, he says, in the day that you do eat it.
Right.
He didn't say, well, if you do this, you know, this is what's going to happen. No, he says, in the day that you do eat it.
Right.
So he knew they were going to.
Mm-hmm.
You will surely die.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now, Yahweh meant for this to happen. Now, the Christians look at this and say, you know, oh, we could have been living in paradise.
Right.
You know, and that when the man messed up, you know, God had to go like, well, what do you know about that? You know, I got to come up with a plan of salvation for this guy. Not realizing the plan of salvation was set up long before anything came about.
Yeah.
Why? Because Yahweh, pure spirit, these attributes took on shape and form in part, not in totality. And when he comes into this state, this super incorporeal state, that is a death. This is the slaying of the lamb before the foundation of the world. See, so this salvation, your salvation was set up before anything came about. That's how, the reason being, Yahweh foreknew what the man would do. So his salvation was set up long before anything else came about. Because Yahweh foreknew, it was his salvation. First thing he set up, the salvation. See? Now that's manifested down here in Egypt when Yahweh instituted with them the Passover. See, they had to eat that lamb. It had to be the death of a lamb. See, in other words, there had to be a death before there was an Exodus. There has to be a death here, then there's an Exodus. See? Or rather, Genesis, rather, that's what I'm saying. There had to be an Exodus before the Genesis.
Mm-hmm.
There had to be an Exodus. A death here, then the Exodus before the Genesis.
Exactly.
There had to be a death. Okay? Now, boy, I think I chewed a big chunk here. All right, let's get, I did say this about the death. Here's Adam and Eve, they're being driven out. Death passes on all mankind. Here you have the two children here. You got Cain and Abel over here. All right? Cain builds the city. You get plague 16. These plates here, I know that these illustrations look nice. I know, you know, we had a good artist this time. But despite that, you have to realize these illustrations are your tools.
Mm-hmm.
These are the tools that Yahweh has given you to use so that you can understand his purpose and his plan. Okay? Like, for example, this particular illustration here. See, I can see here, here's Cain. He murdered his brother, Abel. All right? Quickly get Isaiah 20, I think it's 28 and 9. Line upon line is what I want.
28, 9, and 10.
Thank you.
Isaiah 28:9-10. Whom shall he teach knowledge,
mm-hmm.
and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast.
Mm-hmm.
For precept must be upon precept.
Now, precept. What is a precept? A precept is a principle. A principle is, well, basically this. A principle is something that is immutable.
Mm-hmm.
That means that it cannot change. A principle is perpetual.
It means it goes on and on.
It is eternal.
Mm-hmm.
All right. A principle or precept is irresistible, meaning nothing can stand in its way. You know, I always use the analogy of a cockroach versus a giant steamroller. Who do you think would win? Okay? Because the steamroller is irresistible. That's why
far as the cockroach is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that's what these principles represent: the spirit, the water, and the blood, and or death, burial, resurrection. That's why it says principle or precept must be upon precept. That's why we have it stacked like this. This is the precept of blood. On top of this precept is water. On top of this precept is spirit. All right, continue.
Precept upon precept, line upon line.
Now this is a line. This is, see how these illustrations are lined up? This is a blood line. In other words, if I took this stick here and draw a line like this, there's blood here, there's blood here, he's on the cross. Here in the tabernacle pattern, there's blood here on the altar. Here in the illustration of the Passover, that it is blood on the four horns of the door. Here in this play with Cain kills his brother Abel, that's the shedding of blood.
Right.
That's a blood line. You understand what I'm saying? That's the way it is with all these charts. In principle, that's a blood line. See, continue.
Line upon line.
Now that's one line, and here's another line, the water line. There's a water line here. Water line. Here's John the Baptist baptizing Yahshua in the water, Jordan River. Here's another line, the brazen laver of the altar, brazen laver in the tabernacle. Here's another line coming through the Red Sea. That's water. Here's another line. His consciousness is immersed in wickedness. That's the principle. It's an immersion. It's not with water, but it is a principle of immersion in wickedness. You understand what I'm saying here? Line upon line. This is how you understand the charts.
Right.
This is how you understand the principles laid out on this chart. Why? Because this is an illustration of a panoramic vision.
Right.
Put on a two-dimensional surface. See, it's not going to operate on its own here, but it's going to resonate within here. That's what it's designed to do, so that you would see the principles in here. Continue.
Here a little and there a little.
Here a little and there a little. What do you mean? I quote it, Isaiah 9 and 10, 48, 9 and 10. It says, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. See, in other words, you have to draw a little bit from what Moses wrote, the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and here a little over in the prophecy or in the testimony. See, because the testimony is drawn out from what Moses wrote. Everything the prophets had to say had to be verified or confirmed by something Moses wrote in the first five books. It has to be that way. He's going to fulfill it.
Right.
John here on the Isle of Patmos, he's going to confirm both what Yahshua is doing as well as Moses and the prophets. That's why people don't understand the Bible. Because they don't understand how it's structured. They don't understand there's a law, there's a prophecy, and there's a fulfillment involved here. It's a threefold process. See? Continue.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people.
What do you mean, stammering lips? Well, Moses back here, if you remember the story back here, he was with the angel in the burning bush here, and he was being commissioned to go down, and Moses, one of the excuses Moses came up with, I'm slow of speech. And he was. He was not mellifluous like Charlton Heston in the movie, you know, all debonair. No, the man stuttered. He had a speech impediment.
Right.
And Yahweh said, well, look, your brother Aaron down there speaks well, he'll be your mouthpiece. You will be a law unto him, and he will be your prophet. So you got Aaron and Moses going down together into Egypt, the law and the prophet,
right,
rendering judgment on Pharaoh and the Egyptians, the law and the prophet. That's why even with the apostles, when they went out, they got sent out two by two. Why? Representing the law and the testimony. See, one can speak, the other one gets the scriptures. Or one gets tired, switch out. He'll speak, then you get the scriptures. The law and the testimony, you know, it's in a, you know, that's why it's done like that. See, keep reading.
To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing,
mm-hmm.
Yet they would not hear.
They would not hear this little basic simple principle, see, of precept upon precept, see, line upon line. See, here,
There's a bloodline here. Cain killed his brother Abel. All right? His consciousness is immersed in wickedness. And then a mark was put on Cain. See, why a mark? See, just like you slap a mark there. Why? Because the high priest had to slap oil on his head. He anointed with oil. He got, well, Cain got anointed with a mark. And here he is. He's got his old lady here. See, and he's telling us, yeah, baby, I'm going to build this city. And don't worry, yeah, baby, I'm gonna get you. You can have your little garden over there. And, you know, everything. And she's there. She's like, all right, anything you say, baby. You know, she's 40 weeks pregnant. That's the 40 principle on it, because she's getting ready to have a baby. That's right. She's 40 weeks pregnant. And see, Cain, see, the things he said, because he put the mark was put on his head. See, Elohim put the mark on his head so that nobody else would touch it. Well, he used that and said, well, see, me and Elohim are tight.
Yeah.
If you want to talk to Elohim, you need to talk to me. What are you saying? Go back here. What's in the holy place here? You got a lampstand, table of shewbread, and an altar of incense. Concisely, a light, a bread, and an intercessor. That's what Cain told the people. I'm your light. And the words he speak, eat them up. Because I'm the one, you know, it's me. And I'm the intercessor. You want to talk to Elohim? Come talk to me, because you can't touch me. See this mark? Elohim said, you can't touch me. So I mean, me and him tight. Want me to put in a good word for you? That's what he did. It's principles you're looking for. It's precepts. See, this is the template that you're going to use. To see the precepts here. And then here, this is the veil principle. Here we got blue, the second department of veil, blue, purple, and scarlet. Come over here. That would be like the Jordan River in the migratory pattern. The Jordan River separated so that they could come through. Cain's wife, her cervix separated so that her son, Enoch, could be born.
Right.
See, that's the veil principle. And then here you got Enoch and his wife, and he's sitting there, and look here. You know, they look a little more prosperous now. You know, they didn't come up some, you know, they looking here, they, you know, they kind of ratchet looking like right here. You know, but see now, you know, they look a little more prosperous now. But look here he is in the midst, surrounded, flanked by his wife and his son. That's him imitating the Ark of the Covenant with the two archangels and the clouds sitting there. That's him imitating his authority. See, building a city without divine specifications, without divine instructions, not like this tabernacle, and setting himself up. And look, his family ruled that age, the antediluvian age. That he was the government of that age, okay? Now, that age got destroyed by a flood. And see, and then 101 years later, we have human government. First, we had Noah's coming, and maybe we should read that. Quickly, because I know I'm running out of time. Get to Genesis, the 9th chapter. Nine and one, quickly.
Genesis 9 and 1. And Elohim blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea, into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be food for you, even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the life which is in the blood shall you not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed.
Mm-hmm.
For in the image of Elohim made he man.
Okay, good enough. Now, in other words, now the animals, he said the fear of you and the dread of you will be on all the animals. All right? Here's the ark. Resting in the mountains of Ararat. The mountains, I didn't say on Mount Ararat. It's resting between two mountains.
Right.
Why am I saying that? I could draw a line, just like the cloud resting between two archangels.
Mm-hmm.
See, it's the principles you're looking for, okay? Now, the animals, they come out first. That's not unusual, because look over here. On the sixth day of creation, who was created first? The animals or the man?
Yeah.
The man, well, you see what I'm saying? The man was last. So it's got to be the same over here. The animals come out first, then came out the man. The animals go out, they stake their claim, being the territorial creatures that they are. And then the man comes along. And then when the man comes along, you know, he's saying, oh, man, this is a nice spread. You know, I'll make this my North 40. You know, there's a little stream down there. I think I'll build a house over there. Yeah, I think I can do something with this, man. Yeah. And so he's out here plowing, not knowing that he had staked out the land for himself, not knowing that the land had already been claimed by maybe a pack of wolves or something, or lions or tigers or bears, oh my. And you know, you're out there plowing, and next thing you know, you're set upon by some wolves, you know, and it was a problem. It was a problem, but before I get to that, quickly read, jump down to 13, because I want to get this 11. Covenant in. 11. Quickly.
11. And I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And Elohim said, this is a sign of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh.
All right, good enough. All right, now, that's the we have it right here. Here's the bow in the sky. See, and the bow, draw a line, would be like the flash of the Shekinah.
Right.
In the cloud on the Day of Atonement when the high priest went up here. See, okay? Everything is correlatable. And you're just making comparative analysis here with principles. All right? Now, as I said, the animals were wild. And it was a problem. See, and so the land cried out for a hero. And see, and here's this hero that the land cried out for. Genesis 10 and 8. Quickly, because I'm out of time here.
Genesis 10 and 8. And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter opposing Yahweh. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter opposing Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
And the beginning of the kingdom was Babel, and Erech, and Akkad, and Calneh, in the land of Shinar.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the land he went to Assyria, and built in Nineveh, in the city streets, and Calah, and Rezin between Nineveh and Calah, the same as a great city.
All right, now. That was Nimrod. And he built this Tower of Babel, which was, you stop and think about it, was a public works project, which means that it was paid for by taxes. And that was the thing that Nimrod had instituted and invented. The concept, we have it right here. Number two, human government, Tower of Babel. What we considered to be government or forms of government, the basis of it got started here at the Tower of Babel with Nimrod. Tower of Babel was part of it, but Nimrod was the one who started it. We just read Nimrod built roads, he built cities, he conquered places, he was a builder. He built Nineveh just like Cain built the city of Enoch without divine specification, without divine instructions. And listen, Nimrod hit up with on a novel idea because he was a great hunter. And I just told you, the animals were a problem. So Nimrod, and not just the animals, the four-footed ones, but the two-footed ones, they were just as bad. I'm talking about man, because you had robbers and brigands and thieves, and, you know, because they were people that would just lay back and say, you see them fools down in the valley? Let them work all summer. And when the autumn come and they pull in the harvest, we'll just go down there and raid them and take their stuff. There were people like that. Who's going to stop? And they was like, who's going to stop us? You know?
Mm-hmm.
See? So the land cried out for a hero. Nimrod was one to the people. What he said was this. I said, okay, I will protect you. And he came up with a novel concept. Walled enclosures.
Trump.
He built a city and he put walls around the city. Walled enclosures. That was his novel concept. And the second thing Nimrod came up with was the concept of taxation. Or tribute. Because Nimrod built the city, and he said, y'all can come and live in my city. Hey, look, I will build roads. I will bring a water system in for fresh water. I'll have my men patrol the streets so you won't get accosted, you know, thieves. You have a little area downtown for the business, you can start your businesses and that. I, Nimrod, will do all these things. But this is what you gotta do. You gotta pay me tribute.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta pay taxes. And listen, this is the thing, like what was brought up about entitlements. This is what we as civilizations expect. Because from government, what do we expect? We expect police protection,
right.
The fire departments,
right.
health and human services,
right.
streets and sanitation,
mm-hmm.
the public utilities.
Mm-hmm.
We expect that. Now because of the advent of digital technology, we expect more. I want my MTV, I want my Facebook, I want my Twitter account, I want, you understand what I'm saying? I want my Snapchat, I want, and listen, I heard people talk about Facebook being a utility now because it's so ingrained in people's lives and stuff. I mean, businesses advertise on it. I communicate with a lot of people. The only reason why I got onto it because I was going to school. I was in film school, and my classmates were in on it. I didn't know what the hell it was. I just thought it was just a way to keep up with them. And then I come find out, wow, it's bigger than what I thought. And see, but these are the entitlements that we as governments, we expect. Look, all these governments here, they had to do that kind of stuff. The scripture says, I don't know where it is, but it says the love of money is the root of all evil.
Right.
And Yahshua said, you know, who do you love? You either love Yahweh or you love mammon, which is the god of money. See? And so the love of money, you know, I mean, and look, war and stuff, it's just nothing but gangsterism on a bigger scale.
Right.
You know, when I'll give you an example. I love this example. 2 Kings 24:1, and I'm almost to my point because this is where the entitlements come from, what we call entitlements. But this is just to show you an exercise of power.
2 Kings 24:1.
Uh-huh.
In his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became the servant three years.
Okay, now Nebuchadnezzar came up and conquered Judah. And Jehoiakim, who was the king of Judah at the time, became his servant. In other words, he became his boy. In other words, in fact, you don't even read about a fight. He just walked up in there and just slapped it and just said, look, I'm taking over here. I'm running this place. All right, from now on, you pay me tribute. All right, at the end of the year, I want my cut. I want gold, silver, linen, slaves, fruits, vegetables. At the end of the year, I want my cut. All right, and that's simple as that. And 3 years, Read that again.
In his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his servant 3 years. Then he turned and rebelled against him.
Now, after 3 years of working for Nebuchadnezzar, because Jehoiakim was king, in other words, Nebuchadnezzar said, you can still stay on the throne, but I want my cut. You know, I'll let you be the HNIC, you know. In case you don't know what that is, the head Negro in charge. But you work for me now, you know. You're now the newest employee of the Greater Babylonian Prosperity Corporation. In other words, whatever goods and money you got is coming to me. And isn't that what gangsters do? This is like what you call protection. You know, that's what the gangsters do. They say, you know, well, you don't want people coming in, you know, rough shoving your business up. We're gonna give you protection, but you gotta pay us.
Right,
you know. That's all it was. That's all war is. Like it was said, you know. Well, we want their land, or they doing this. But the whole bottom line is the love of money.
Mm-hmm.
All right, really. Mm-hmm. Just to show you that, you know, this is how governments operate. And see, look, all these governments are laws. It's trying to reflect the great law of the spirit.
You want the scripture about love and money?
Well, you have it.
1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all evil.
But that's quoting something from the Old Testament. Where's it quoting from?
It's not in this. Which, while some coveted after they have erred from the faith and pierced.
But that's good enough. I mean, Paul's quoting from the Old Testament when he says that. I forget where it's at. But that's where he's quoting from, about the love of money is the root of all evil. So anyway, here's Elohim. This is Elohim. And this is what he is, these attributes. Satan is created in the image and likeness of these attributes, okay? And this is the attributes he tries to have you worship in a carnal way through human government. Because human government, they project themselves as intelligent and wisdom and knowledgeable and beauty and love. You know, the government said, we love you, love us back. You know, justice, foundation, power. This is what the government, you know, that's the whole idea behind the national anthem and all that kind of stuff. It's the worship. See, on the fourth day of creation, the sun, moon, and stars was created. All right, quickly. Somebody get me plate.
Oh gosh, which one is it?
Nine, right behind you. Yeah, I gotta fly with this one. Now, you see here, this is the same spirit law here, that's creating everything. Here, we have the stars here on the veil. We have the planet Saturn highlighted for a reason. Here we have the moon here in the holy place, which is the lesser light. See, this is the sun, which is the greater light that rules the day. The moon, the lesser light, that rules tonight. Okay? Now, if you've been in darkness, just from a natural standpoint, then you've been ruled by the moon. The moon is representative of these cardinal ordinances. Mm-hmm. Jeremiah 31:35, quickly. And maybe I've got 3 minutes left. I can tie this together, I hope.
Oh. 31:35.
Uh-huh.
Thus saith Yahweh, which giveth the sun for a light by day,
uh-huh.
and the ordinance of the moon and of the stars for a light by night.
Is that plural or singular, ordinance?
Ordinances.
Thank you. The ordinances.
Of the moon.
These are the ordinances of the moon. And listen, not just these cardinal ordinances, any cardinal ordinance. Because the Gentiles,
right.
Romans 2:14 said they did by nature. The things that were in the law. In other words, the Gentiles did these things too, but Yahweh never told them.
Right.
In India, every spring, a million Hindus go out to the Ganges River and they do a ritual baptism. Now, Yahweh never told them to do that, but that's an ordinance of the moon.
Mm-hmm.
See, if you're in darkness, the only thing that comes up at night is the moon and the stars. So if you're in darkness or in ignorance, then you're ruled by the moon.
Right.
Got it? The ordinances of the moon, even though I wasn't under these 613, but you're under some cardinal ordinance,
right.
something that you made up or something like that, that's
right.
the ordinance of the moon.
That's right.
And we're trying to get you out from under there and be in the light. Where can I go? 2 Peter 1:19.
Second Peter 1:19.
Mm-hmm.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy, wherein you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place.
Now, see, this is the light. Yahshua is the light that shineth in a dark place. What dark place? Your ignorance. When the gospel is preached to you and the veils are rent, and he, like the flash of the Shekinah, lights up your soul. That's the light shining in a dark place. Because
right.
prior to that, you didn't know.
That's right.
Read.
Until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart.
Till the day, this is the day star that rises in your heart. Just like the sun rises. Here's sunset. Talking about Adam. Because he died and the whole human race died with it. Here's the sun setting. This is the sunset. And this is all in darkness. 4,000 years of darkness, spiritually speaking. But now here's the sunrise. Talking about Yahshua and Messiah, early Sunday morning. Both sun, S-U-N-S, rising together. The sunrise. See, children of the light. That's what we are. Anything else there?
Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scriptures of any private interpretation.
See, this is not... What you're looking at is not a private interpretation
right.
up here. This is not something of a concept of a man. See, everything that you see up here is in the Bible. And according to a divine pattern of the universe, which is him. See, go ahead quickly.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man,
mm-hmm.
but holy men of Yahweh spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
Okay, so now here, these are the attributes. This is what Yahweh Elohim is. Satan is creating the image and likeness of this, and he tries to exude those attributes as well. See, he tries to make them manifest throughout these empires. Wisdom, intelligence, and listen, these people that rule these, they weren't stupid people. Nebuchadnezzar was a smart man. Built the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, one of the ancient seven wonders of the ancient world.
Right.
See, and they all had their own form of government, what they thought, how they thought people should rule each other. Government is really simple. Government is just simply a behavioral thing between two human beings. You can see government at work. Just go to L.A. sometime, go downtown where the homeless people are at. Even among themselves, they got rules and regulations. You can't just come up into a little, colony of folks and say, well, this is what I want, and you come up in there and steal somebody's shoes when they're sleeping. It's like, no, we ain't gonna go for that. You can't stay here, You understand my point? It's just codes of behavior.
Right.
See, because back here, in this age with Cain, listen, let me tell you something, these folks were rough. You step on my foot, I'll kill you. Know what you gonna do? Your family ain't that big and bad, you know what I'm saying? My club is bigger than yours. that kind of thing, So when they come down to Nimrod had enough sense to say, well, we gotta come up with some rules of behavior between folks. So I'm gonna come up with a law. This is what the law gonna be. See, and that's man's coming with the law, not understanding the spirit law.
Right.
Because see, it would be like this. If I accidentally killed your cow, the natural thing to do would be, oh, I'm sorry. That'd be the first thing. Let me replace the cow. All right. Maybe I'll give you 1,000 gallons of milk. Maybe I can work it off to pay for it. That would be, but there were people that said, man, screw you. The cow shouldn't have got in my way. And no, I ain't giving you a damn thing. Now what about it? How you gonna make me? There were people like that. So what are you gonna do then? How does one get restitution like that? See, so they had to come up with something. Deterrence, penalties, stuff like that. When the natural governing thing, as it was said, love covers all things. Out of love, I'm gonna replace your cow.
Right.
Or I'm gonna do this. That's how people, the natural way to govern, which is what these folks have tried to make people do. See? To make people do right. And you can't. There's no way you make somebody do right. That has to come from within.
Right.
That's all that is to it. We're out of time today, but I hope some things we got. I didn't get to my full point. I think I got 90%. So that's better than zero. But take the time to look at these things and come to class and ask Yahweh to show you these principles. You got a question.
What's the significance of a rainbow today?
The significance of a rainbow today? The same significance it was back then.
There will no longer be a universal flood.
They will not be, not by water. Fire maybe, but not by water.
Right.
It's the same principle.
Earthquake.
Well, he said not by water.
Oh, right.
Not by water. Just so, and so the bow is still there, so his promise is still there. He's not going to destroy the world by water. Now, fire, that might be something a little different. See? But not by water. And that wasn't a full end either, because the earth abided.
Right.
But now, at the end of this age, the earth will not abide.
Right.
And we, as according to our 10th aim, we expect a new earth state. See? And that is coming, and that comes about, everybody gets that. Yeah. Even Adam.
Yeah.
Who's been waiting longer than anybody. He gets his reward the same time we do. In other words, it's like the parable of the penny. We all get the same penny no matter what hour of the day we come in. See, that's the justification of Yahweh, yes.
I looked up the love of money in Proverbs 20:20, and it says, the faithful man shall abound with blessings, but he that maketh haste to be rich shall not be unpunished. So it goes further than the other one.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Thank you for coming out. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to learn something about your Creator, because the time you take to learn about your Creator will reap for you in dividends. In other words, the 2 hours you take today to learn about your Creator can dividend into eternal life. Okay? Thank you for your time and your patience and for those few words.
Hallelujah.
Praise Yahshua.
truly appreciate the words of the previous speaker. That will conclude today's lecture. Do we have any announcements today? Any announcements? No announcements, Steve?
Yeah, I guess we could.
Okay.
Okay. I'll try to get to it. There is a event that's happening in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. And I'm trying to open up this file.
October 18th to 20.
Yes. All right. Basically, this is, let's see. We are happy to announce a spiritual event session October 18th to 20th, 2019 at the Homewood Suites by Hilton, 40 Bay St. South in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Please come and fellowship with us in Canada and all the brethren. The purpose? To continue to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim. You know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists, with the desire to assemble the brethren in righteousness, peace, and joy. The strength we get through Yahshua by being assembled in the unity of the Spirit strengthens us and keeps us upright in the face of the adversary, so we must strive to be in that spirit. And the theme for the session will be, who shall separate us from the love of the Messiah? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. And yeah, that's the theme. And it's Friday, yeah, so there will be from Friday, October the 18th, to Saturday, October 19th, Sunday, October the 20th. And I didn't get a chance to print this out, but when I do, I'll have it posted up, so if you're interested. I'm considering going if I can, but just to let you know. And also, we all know about the event in November, right? Albuquerque. We're all for that. All right. Thank you. That's it.
And that invitation is posted on our Facebook page?
Yes.
So you can read that invitation by visiting our Facebook page, Ontario Class IDMR.
No, the other way around.
IDMR Ontario Class. Excuse me. And about the Albuquerque, New Mexico conference, the registration is full for that right now. So if you're registered, then good, come on. But according to the fire code, no further seats can be had there. So they're not accepting any more registration for that conference. So take note of that. Is that all for our announcements today? Okay. Could we please stand for the doxology? Wait a minute. Donations may be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser.
When do we hold class?
And we hold class Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. And on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. And every fourth Sunday we have a Spanish class from 9:30 a.m. to 10:45 a.m. Doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Amen.
I'm
going to
get
I kind of broke my belt. Why?
Samuel, yep. How are you? Did you do this, Iggy?
Did you do this?
Thank you.
What is it?
These are the parts that I've been having some trouble with remembering. So she printed it out. How's it going? I like that suit. That's a nice one too. Why's the other brother not have a suit on? I know this is a two
year
suit.
They didn't enforce it, but they said, you know,
sometimes.